I can share my presentation, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes. So have you facing any difficulty?
No, sir.
Sir, please unmute. Sir, please unmute yourself.
Yes.
Sir, your mic is on mute mode. Now it's okay. Yes.
Yeah. You are able to see my screen?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll be talking about the nonlinear optical properties of colorants computational approach. So I am unable to change the screen. Just one.
See the shared screen.
So now it's okay.
Yes, again muted. Sir, your mic, you have muted. Okay, sir.
Okay. Now, okay. Now, as you know, many areas of science and technology.
Sir, make it full screen.
Okay, what is it?
Sir, please make it full screen.
Full screen.
Okay, sir. I think.
Just give me 1 minute. Just give me. I'm just trying.
Yang baru.
Are you able to see the full screen now? Hello?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Here I am, it shows full screen.
Okay.
So I'll do one thing, I'll stop and then start the new share.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Now we are able to see, sir.
Full screen, you are able to see?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Sorry for the initial trouble. Okay. As you know, many areas of science and technology have benefited from the advances in the computational theoretical techniques over the past few decades, but you can say even this half century. In a number of cases, the theoretical predictions have directly impacted the design of new materials with several unique characteristics. So an understanding of the details of molecular structures and their relationship with the desired properties of such materials has always been a key factor for successful interplay between theory and experiment, and particularly commercial utility of the materials. So nonlinear optical properties of material is one of the very important characteristics which can today be calculated to the desired accuracy. Now if you see the modeling approach, there are so many intuition-based modeling, particularly in understanding the nonlinear optical properties of the materials, particularly the first hyperpolarizability response, which has been studied extensively. The bond length alternation motif, bond order alternation motif, and bond ellipticity alternation, all these three can be obtained very easily from optimized structure. Even if it is semi-empirical optimization, from there we can really be able to get a rough idea of the enhancement of the nonlinear optical properties. And the idea of generating optopolar molecules, and then by judging whether there is a strong response of the excited state, and particularly using the pi, twisted pi electron molecules, the non-planar molecules, where there is no much of a center of symmetry, or modify the admixture of crinoid and aromatic structures. Crinoid structures are supposed to show extensively high nonlinear optical property compared to the aromatic structures, which are very stable, where the excitation energy is pretty high. So you don't populate the excited state so easily. So nonlinear optical property being the property originating from the first excited state mainly, so crinoid structures give you the better response. Mostly the molecules what we use for the nonlinear optical materials are too large, sometimes mainly oligomers or polymers. So the quantum mechanical methods or quantum chemical methods are prohibitively costly. You cannot run a simulation. Of course, today we have the DFT techniques, and we have sophisticated theoretical models. So we can use, there are a lot of very good algorithms which have come, so we can comfortably do the computations, though we cannot do the quantum wave function based computations. Okay. So the fact, if you look at the theoretical aspect of the nonlinear optical property, it was demonstrated much earlier in the year 1931 by Bopert Meyer. She demonstrated that a molecule can simultaneously absorb at least two photons, of course subsequently multiple photons, which was totally against the formulation of the Planck, Einstein, all these people, they told only one photon at a time. That's how they demonstrated the photoelectric effect and all. But this was a drastic diagonally opposite theory, which was developed by Gaupert-Meyer 10 years after the Einstein's formulation. But then this kind of effects could not be realized because this nonlinear optical effects come into picture only when you use highly pulsed radiation source when you interact the molecule with the electromagnetic radiation, so which happened only somewhere close to 1960. So then there's a lot of interest, and this have a lot of applications in optical computing, optical communications, optical data storage, optical switches, frequency generation, that is multiple frequency generation. I have again, frequency generation means the frequency doubling, tripling. So optical switching at very high frequencies. So in these areas, in day-to-day life, we use a lot of non-linear optical materials. So usually the materials what was initially used, they are all of inorganic materials. The main reason being they have very high thermal stability. And the first it was demonstrated in a ruby laser when it was directed to quartz crystal. So the potassium titanium phosphate, lithium niobate, lithium tantalate, all these kinds of things were used in the frequency conversions. But then subsequently the borate crystals, they were really very interesting compounds. They are very, very high damage threshold and a broad transparency, which are very important requirements for nonlinear optical device applications. So this lithium triborate and barium borate became important crystals for all kinds of nonlinear optical devices. And the pyrite crystals, all those became big crystals. But all these materials have got their inherent drawback. They don't have that kind of fast response, but applications need very fast response. And they have very little architectural flexibility. By this we mean the processability of the inorganic crystals is not that easy. So then there was extensive research. Then organic crystals, they become very interesting materials. So they, particularly the simple nitrourea was initially it was examined. So you can understand the structure property relationship very well in the case of organic materials, and you can theoretically understand all these things. So you can design the materials with the required property. So mostly the organic materials which show the nonlinear optical effect, they have an electron releasing and electron withdrawing groups through a system of pi conjugated double bonds. So they exhibit quadratic nonlinear optical response. If you see the nonlinear optical, when an organic molecule, and when you want to say that you need a very high interaction or a very effective interaction between the electromagnetic radiation and organic molecule, so one can think of, you cannot think of anything other than dyes, because they interact with the visible portion of the electromagnetic radiation very effectively. That's why they are colored. So that is between 400 and 800 nanometers. And it's not only that, most of the dyes also absorb the ultraviolet radiation as well as the infrared radiation. So you get a very large absorption cross section mostly. So when an organic dye or a colorant absorbs it interacts with the photon, which has got the momentum, that is energy upon the velocity of light. So it is partially transferred to the molecule, and nothing happens to the molecule, nothing happens to the electron. So we say the energy transfer is prohibited. So we say there's a scattering of photons. The scattered photons are the almost same frequency. So we say it is an elastic scattering. But if the time scale is such that that it doesn't violate the uncertainty principle. The de-excitation of the system from the virtual state back to the ground state happens, and you have no emission. So this we call as the linear optics. Suppose if this relation is slightly violated, it can, when it happens, when you have got an incident intensity, a very high intensity electromagnetic radiation, simultaneously two photons or the multiple photon scattering or absorption occurs. So two or more photons are annihilated and absorbed by the molecule in a single quantum mechanical process. The frequency of the scattered photon, in those cases, they are different from the absorbed photon, sometimes two quanta, three quanta. Then we say that's a second harmonic generation. So the nonlinear optical properties start coming into the picture when you have got very high intensity light and when such a thing happens in the molecule. So the from the ground state after the interaction, it goes to the intermediate virtual state, which is separated from the first excited state by an energy E. So this kind of nonlinear process occurs. Okay. Now the nonlinear optical properties can be experimentally understood with the help of a laser light. We have several experimental techniques, the hyper-Rayleigh scattering, electric field induced second harmonic generation, Z-scan technique. Now all these techniques is highly costly. They're cost intensive. You have to design your own setup, or of course now ready-made meshes are available to do all these things. And suppose if you want to make a series of compounds and find out that which is more efficient as an NLO4, so then you have to synthesize so many things, you have to process. So then it is very easy to if you have a theoretical model which can suggest at least not exactly what is the nonlinear optical coefficients, but at least a trend in a series of molecules, so then it becomes very easy. So the computational approaches become very handy. It complements the experimental techniques and it helps in designing better and better nonlinear optical materials without much experimental, both on the synthetic aspect as well as on the testing aspect. So the computational methods are always in demand. Now, how will you understand when a material will possess a very large nonlinear optical responses it will have? Usually, the molecule should, they are all, we call them as push-pull chromophores or the donor-acceptor chromophores. A donor, which is a filled orbital, and an acceptor, which is a vacant orbital, is separated by a pi bonds. So we say there is a donor-acceptor interaction, and this interaction can be through bond or through space kind of interaction. So these molecules will have very large ground state dipole moment. It will have a low-lying pi star. That's in a state transition, either in the UV visible region or UV region or the visible region. So leading to very high charge transfer, mainly intramolecular charge transfer occurring along the molecular axis. Then it will have very large electronic hyperpolarized abilities compared with the non-centrosymmetric organic molecules. So the molecule also should crystalline, should be able to be crystallized in a non-centrosymmetric manner. Or it has to be cold in a non-centrosymmetric symmetric manner, so that you harvest a lot of non-linear optical responses from the system. So charge transferred excited state denotes is a photo-induced Franklin and electron excited state, which differs significantly from the ground state. So this difference, this kind of photo-induced process creates a lot of difference in the dipole moment. So there is a significant difference between the ground state dipole moment and the excited state dipole moment. To study this theoretically, we have to have a perturbative approach to understand this. What happens in presence of an external field, where the external field so people say that sum over state expression of the two level system proposed by Lauda, but then all this kind of these sum over state expressions as well as the we can say the derivatives of the dipole moments, all these kind of things can be understood very easily from the spectroscopic parameters, that is the transition moments or the oscillator strength. And all these dipole moment differences can be obtained very easily by measuring the absorption spectra in a linear regime. So then it was Auger and Chembla who proposed a simple model which mimics the complicated happenings which in within the molecule. In this simple two-level model, the linear response, that is the polarizability along the direction of the molecular axis, we call the charge transfer polarization or the XX polarization. This is the expression. This varies directly with the square of the transition dipole moment and the energy between the ground and first excited state, that is EEG, and the transition inversely with the. So this indicates that if you have low energy excitation, you'll be able to enhance the alpha. If the transition dipole moment is more, you'll be able to enhance the alpha. Now this mu, the E, that is the excitation energy, can be very easily obtained by the absorption, and you can also today get it from the DFT without having the molecule in place. If you write the structure, run a TDDFT computation, you'll be able to get the vertical excitation energy. The transition dipole moment also come. The transition dipole moment is associated with the oscillator strength, and the oscillator strength is obtained by this particular the equation, that F is equal to 4.32 to 10 power minus 9. So this, the integral which is there, it can be obtained from the absorption graph. So if you simply run an absorption spectrum, you'll be able to get the transition dipole moment as well as the excitation energy. So then you'll be able to get the value of alpha. So this is what is the advantage of the Auger's model. Then in the same way, using this transition dipole moment, and if you see the expression for beta, which is suggested by the Auger's equation, the beta arises from the charge transfer is again directly proportional to the transition dipole moment, and the excitation energy inversely proportional to the excitation energy, and this delta mu ct is the difference between the ground and the excited state dipole moments. So under static conditions, most of these when the excitation energy is equal to the laser when the laser frequency is zero, when you use this under steady state condition, the equation becomes very simple. So from the steady state measurements, you can get the transition dipole moment as well as the excitation energy. But only thing now left to calculate beta from the spectroscopic measurement is the difference between the ground state and excited state dipole moment. The ground state and excited state dipole moment, the difference can also be very easily obtained if the molecule is solvatochromic. I will explain to you. If the molecule is solvatochromic, by taking into account the Stokes shift and with the Lippert-Mataga theory, Lippert-Mataga model, with this particular expression, the polarity function, if you plot against the Stokes shift, the slope gives you the delta mu, the charge transfer. with this and what you need is a Onsager radii, but Onsager radii can be very easily calculated having the atomic volumes, or you can get from the DFT if you have the optimized geometry. It's very easy to get this. But apart from Rippert-Mandaga theory, you have got many other method, many other models where you have got different solvent polarity functions. Using that, you can get very accurately the value of delta mu. So once you have that, now you can get the value of beta also. Then the second order hyperpolar SLBT, again, if you see, it is proportional to the transition dipole moment according to Audet's model. And again, there is another expression, which is a nonlinear expression, and it is inversely proportional to the third power of the excitation energy. Now here again, all the parameters what we have evaluated from the solventochromic data, that is delta mu E and mu G E, as well as the delta E. So with this model, with the spectrophotometer and with the Excel sheet, you'll be able to get the alpha, beta and gamma. You don't need very large instrumentation to do this. So here I have summarized. The values for beta and gamma are directly proportional to the square of the transition dipole moment, inversely proportional to the energy of excitation. See, excess dipole moment, that is delta mu, is a function of Stokes shift according to Lippert-Mandaga equation or many other. There are so many models which are still accurate. The Macrae model is there. So many models are there. So it is computationally or from simple theoretical extension of the theoretical approach. Of course, all these theoretical models are got very large assumptions. But with this assumption goes for all, because if you have suppose I want to understand a Coumarin chromophore in terms of its non-linear optical property, I don't have to run an extensive experiment, synthesis all the materials. If I have got all these things, I will be able to get the trend. At least I will be able to say molecule X has got very large non-linear optical property in this set of molecules. Then I can zero down my synthesis, as so I can reduce the cost. Okay, but the density functional theory approach, if you see, so there the external electric field which is induced by the laser light that induced polarization, so that leads to the non-linear optical coefficient, that because there is no linear relation between the power P and E, so you have the non-linear materials. All these things depend on, again, the ground state dipole moment is not same when it interacts with the laser light. So on the excited state, you have a lot of difference. So a simple derivative of this dipole moment, ground state dipole moment, with the electric field, the first order derivative is alpha, second order derivative is beta, and the third order derivative, these are all the partial derivatives. So in most of the DFT course, so they from the optimized structure, so it does what is called finite field computation. You get alpha, beta, and gamma as the output in your computational the file. So using dipole moment in all of this, the Cartesian direction, so your Cartesian coordinates, you'll be able to get the alpha and gamma. Okay. So you can compute purely with the density functional theory computations, or you can calculate using the spectroscopic parameters. Okay. Now, when you go to DFT, again, the solventochromic technique using this Rippert-Mandaga related models, again, you need the material. You need to make the material. Maybe you don't need things like hyper-realist scattering or the scan or the electric field induced second normal generation, but you need the materials. If you want to do away with this, then you need to have a technique to do the computations of the large model. The computation of very large molecules, particularly dyes and all, is really a little bit cumbersome. It is costly, because you have the computations. You need a very, very different hardware and also this thing. That is why people resort to the density function theory computations, not the post Hartree-Fock method. And in the density functional theory computations, the exchange correlation functional, what you choose, the R, its derivative, it is very, very important, very important. So we have a range of the density functions available, which deal, which either based on the semi-local approximations or the local density approximations, or generalized gradient approximations, the functions like EBE or there is M06 series of functions, there are M06, M07 series of functions available. If you want to do the computation with all these kind of density functions, you need a very large basis sets also for that. What happens, semi-local functions are useful, but it doesn't give the right results. But global hybrid functionals, like the very popular GTLYP or the PD hybrids or M06, these kind of functions, the HF exchange, which is there in this, it doesn't, because the nonlinear optical effects, you have to deal with the kind of polar effects at a very large distance. So you have many electron self-interaction, as people call. So this is localization, delocalization error. So this error gives you, of course, this error is compensated if you're only comparing the materials. But when you want the exact design, you need really the accurate values, for which you have to have a trade-off between the HF exchange and the exchange correlation, these kinds of things, to minimize the. So even the global hybrids, they are better, but there's a new kind of functions which are emerged. So this range separated hybrid function, which combines both the flexibility of the global hybrid as well as the requirement of the HF. So this hybrids works it corrects auto corrects the asymptotic inverse asymptotic response tail of the exchange correlation potential. It improves the several molecular properties that are very sensitive to long range interaction. So the Coulomb operator is partitioned. They have a short range as well as long range components. So it is separate partition, I agree with you. This error, using the error function, this error function is 0 to e to infinity. So that the parameter omega, the range separation parameter, it takes care of the length scale, short range and that. So the HF contribution in the short range and the long range, they are different. So the electron-electron interactions are treated separately. So these kind of functions give very very good. It corroborates well with the experimental results, and which you can even if you are doing 100 purely theoretical method, it gives very less error, the mean absolute error or mean signed error. Okay, you can treat the data statistically and try to understand all these things. So these are the kind of the global hybrids where I have given the Hartree-Fock exchange. In the global hybrids, how it is compared to pure HF, and then the range separated hybrid functions. These are the functions which we use usually. I think there are a couple of more functions which are a little bit time consuming, we don't use. Yeah, of course, even for all the systems, we don't use all the functions. Of course, you have to make a choice. Once you do the optimization, you come to know what kind of computational time it needs. So then you'll be able to zero it down to a few functions, which will give you the fast results. Now, having said all these things, I would like to share with you a few sets of molecules which we have investigated using both the techniques, One is maybe a partly experimental and then modeling using the Auder's theory and Auder's equations. Then again, the density function based, theory based formalism. Now, if you look at this, we have compared here the two kinds of the acceptors. You can see the tri-sinofuran based. This is tri-sinofuran based acceptors, and this, these are all commercially used kind of structures. This is not exactly commercial structures, these are systems which are very close to the commercial nonlinear optical materials. So these six compounds we compared very recently, and we could find that even the frequency dependent, I think I have not talked about the frequency dependent nonlinear optical properties, because if the laser, the frequency dependent nonlinear optical properties, you cannot get it from the Auder's model, but in the DFT you can get it, but the theory is a little bit complicated, that's why I have not discussed much. Of course, these molecules are studied for the frequency dependent nonlinear optical materials with DFT. We have published the results recently. We got very good the collaboration between the experimental and theoretical the values. And again, another set of these are the clinoid systems. Usually, clinoid system do not have much of the donor acceptor kind of setup there. But these four molecules, some of the molecules we have also synthesized in this series, some of the molecules we have taken from the published literature. These molecules also show a very large nonlinear optical properties, and we could get very good correspondence between the experimentally observed alpha, beta, as well as gamma in some cases, with the DFT based, as well as solid chromatin based methods. Then the BODP chromophore is a very important chromophore today, not only in the nonlinear optics, but in the triplet sensitizers, many other. Of course, we started the study because these kind of molecules where you have got dimeric and trimeric kind of ODP, they have been mentioned as a substitute for the heavy atom based ODPs, particularly in the photodynamic therapy as well as in triplet sensitization. So that is how we studied this, and we also found that being completely non-centrosymmetric, we found excellent the nonlinear optical effects in this particular system. And again, this molecule is a little bit different from what the sets I have shown earlier. You can see a hydroxy function which is closely associated with the doubly bonded nitrogen of the imidazole system. This leads to what we call as the excited state intramolecular proton transfer. It gives another tautomer which has got very low energy excitation, which leads to very high, as we have seen in the beginning, that which leads to high optical. These are all the molecules synthesized from our own group. Of course, earlier some of them we synthesized, some of them we took from the existing literature, and these are the molecules which we synthesized in our lab. And we measured the nonlinear optical properties, and we did the computation also. These are some of the molecules which absorb, which has got very low energy excitation, close to 600 nanometers. These are all blue dyes. Some of these dyes, with little modification, they are available commercially. We could synthesize all these new dyes because the intermediates which go for the synthesis, they are we could get it from the industries where we have a lot of collaborations. That's why we could make all these types of molecules. I sincerely thank all of you, and I place in record the students who do research with me, plus the teachers who have brought me and my group to this particular level. So we were all trained, particularly I was trained as a traditional color chemist and dealing with the colors which are used in textiles. But then the kind of chemistry which colorants offer, the color chemistry, my teacher always used to tell, you should learn organic chemistry through color chemistry, so you will appreciate the organic chemistry very well. So that is where, because when we wanted to do all these kinds of other the functional applications, other than the textile applications of colorants, it became very easy for us. Our the foundation on the color chemistry was very strong, given by our teachers during the graduation, post-graduation. And I express my sincere gratitude to all of them who have made us very proud with all these kind of contributions in the recent years. Thank you very much. I will be pleased to answer any questions you have.
Participants can ask their questions by posting their questions in chat box. Please. I request you, the panel members also, if you have any doubt, please interact with Shagar sir, because it's a wonderful talk and he's taken from the fundamentals to advanced level. So it's a well elaborated theoretical knowledge that you have given, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I have some questions, sir.
Please,
sir. From your lecture, I could understand that the nonlinear optics depends the geometry and the environment. I mean, the solvent that we have taken, is it?
Yeah, that is right. Actually, the solvent environment and solvatochromism, it has got two important things why we do this. One, we will be able to simulate the environment where these materials are going to be placed when you make the materials, because it will be poured in the polymer. So yeah, then what kind of polar environment where it is placed? So in those environment, what would be the behavior? So that we can judge from the solvatochromic.
The solvent will stabilize and it will influence the internal charge transfer between the donor and acceptor. Is it?
Yes. And that particular using the influence, that is the influence of solvent environment on the intramolecular charge transfer, we'll be able to evaluate the parameters like the transition dipole moment. So it helps to understand the molecular properties also as such, using shifts in the absorption and emission in a solvent. It gives the two purpose. One is the simulation of the environment and study the behavior, and other is to understand the molecular level properties. Actually, what we do in DFT as well as in solvatochromism is we try to understand the property at the molecular level, but the bulk properties are different from the molecular properties, but the trend in the molecular properties will be reflected in the trend in the bulk properties. As a molecule, if it has got very large nonlinear response, even as a polymer, it will have definitely nonlinear optical response to that extent. Yeah.
Anyhow, before we getting the values of hyperpermeability and dipole moment, all the things, we have to optimize this molecule's geometry. I think that is the hectic job, is it?
Yes. You are 100% right, but I did not go into the optimization the things, because the optimization is a bottleneck.
Yes.
In going for any computation. Any kind of computations, not only the nonlinear optical properties, the geometry, what we have, for example, what you see in this slide, it is very difficult to optimize these geometries.
Yes.
I know, there are several ways of, you know, that I don't know if you have gone for the Gaussian, kind of the algorithm which is there in Gaussian.
Yeah.
To get a converged geometry, you have so many techniques.
So yes.
The basis sets what you use, the kind of functions what you use for optimization, that also you have to choose. But ultimately, if you use one method, that is a combination of functional and basis set, you should use the same method for the further computations.
Yes.
With TDDT and other, the polar computation we call, the non-Hilbert, that you are 100% right. The optimization is very crucial. You should have a geometry, optimized geometry with no imaginary frequencies.
Yes.
So it should be a real structure.
Yeah.
You have to alter the molecule, you have to see the, because the convergence is very important. It has to be the minimum energy structure, which is very important. So then we can proceed. Yeah.
And you're using Gaussian software for that, eh?
Yeah, we use Gaussian.
Okay, so how long will it take, sir, for finishing this?
It again depends on the molecule, it again depends on the method.
Yeah, okay.
If you use a functional, the range separated hybrid functions like what I showed, that can be 3 LYP or LC, that long lens corrector, LC omega PBE, with this kind of functionals, it is computationally demanding, it takes more time.
Demanding.
If you do optimization with Hartree-Fock, it will be very fast. And since DFT beats, but one thing, no one can dispute that the geometry what you get from B3 LIP,
yes,
something very close to the X-ray crystallographic geometry. This is well documented. So the optimization using B3 LIP is sufficient for any further computation. But what we want to compute the nonlinear optical properties, the basis set what we use along with B3 LIP is too large, so that makes the computation really very tedious. We have the double zeta, triple zeta basis sets, correlation corrected basis sets, so that CCPV DZ, CCPV TZ, CCPV QZ, or six, if you see the purples, 6311 plus G2, D2P and all, these are the purple basis sets or Dennings basis sets. They are equivalent, but then sometimes you have to choose a very large basis.
Yeah, so it will take more expensive, sir, coupled with
definitely. Yes. The polar computations with the larger basis sets sometimes take days. Of course, if you have a very good cluster, it is very easy to, with simple workstations. I did not go to the intricacies of the computation. Of course, you can further improvise your understanding using the methods like coupled cluster methods. All those things are possible. Again, computationally very, very, very intensive.
Okay, sir. Sir, my last question, sir. Sir, what is the criteria you are taking under consideration for choosing study in non-linear optics? Such that you know the screen shows molecules we have chosen for study nonlinear optics, and what is the criteria you have seen in that molecules, and what is the criteria we have to listen, whether it is already synthesized molecules and reported molecules,
both we take. As color chemists, we synthesize only colored molecules. So all colored molecules will have intramolecular mass transfer.
Yes.
So then, they will definitely show the non-linear optical activity. But what we do is we look at the commercial candidates which are used. Say for example, the tricyanofuran molecules, they are used commercially. So we see that, and then we try to modify so that whether we can enhance. Of course, after doing all these things, it has to be made also in a cheaper way. So that comes into picture. So we can make a molecule which will have very large non-linear optical property. Again, many other things like thermal stability, all these things should be associated with the thermogrammetric studies. All these. Of course, we do. When you communicate a paper, the referees also ask all these things. So we may have to ask.
It was a wonderful lecture, sir. So anyhow, keep touch with us. KSM DBM College Research Department of Chemistry and Polymer Chemistry need your advice and need your guidelines in future. Please make a cooperate with us. Thank you, sir. So I hand out to Dr. Deepa teacher.
Mm-hmm.
His deliver her lot of thanks.
Okay.
Very good morning to all. Respected principal, our most valued chief guest, participants, scholars, colleagues, and my dear friends. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of the organizing committee of ICC-MCR 2020, KSMDB College, Astangota, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to Dr. N. Shekhar for gracing your important work and sharing with us your findings and opinions today. I may like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Shekhar for giving us an excellent coverage of the topic, the nonlinear optical properties of the colorance computational approach. He has explained us how the costly experimental methods can be replaced to some extent through a computational approach so that we can reduce the errors. He had gone through the basics too. We are all inspired by your great words, sir. Now I wish to thank our principal who has enlightened our minds to organize such conferences in our department. He always tried to motivate us in all respects. I, on behalf of the organizing committee, express my sincere thanks to all the participants for being a part of this event. I, on behalf of the organizing committee, express my thanks to all the colleagues, scholars, teachers from various colleges and universities, and dear students for attending the conference. I strongly believe that you all might have been benefited by the eminent talk. Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So, ending this fourth session. The next session will start very soon, 11:30. Goma sir from Department of Atomic Energy, scientific officer, he will deliver the next lecture. It will start 11:30, and participants will get a link for that Zoom meeting in their Telegram group as well as their mail. So, thank you, Chandra sir. With your permission, now I binding up this session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah.